My name is Sandy Edwards. I'm from Orlando, Florida. So it was quite an interesting journey to get up here, but the weather is awesome. So I have been in the website space for about 4 years now, and I specialize in search engine optimization and business growth through content marketing. So today I'm going to be talking a little bit about the Yoast SEO plugin and how you can use this plugin to help optimize your website all on your own without having to necessarily get any developers involved or anything like that. So I'm going to go ahead and get started, and we'll take questions at the end. I've specifically saved time for that for you guys. So why does SEO even matter? I know it's pretty much a catchphrase that everybody talks about, but there's a few key points to remember when you're talking about building your business to keep in mind. As a business owner, you want people to visit your site. You don't want them going to your competitors, you want them coming to you. You want people, once they visit, to stay on your site. And when you're looking at things in the search engine, you want to make sure that the text that you are presenting to people to click on is something that's going to want to make them click and stay. And then you want visitors on your site to ultimately convert. So it's great that they got there, it's great that they stayed there, but what's going to make it so that they give you money? So how does Yoast SEO WordPress plugin help with this? It gives you easy access to all of your on-site data when it comes to how the search engines see your site. It puts all of your features into one plugin. So all of those SEO features where you could have, you know, 5 or 6 SEO plugins, it puts all of them in one place for you. And it covers a multitude of SEO facets. It covers your metadata, it covers your title tags, being able to do social Twitter cards, having your sitemap ready, and it also has advanced settings for those that are a little bit more development savvy. It also allows you to have complete control. So even if you are having a web shop or an SEO shop manage your search engine optimization for you using this tool, you as a business owner can still see what they're doing, see what they're up to, and keep them in check. So, where do I start? That's a really good question. The tool is very robust, like I said, so it's good to make sure that you have a plan in place so that way you know where you're starting and where you're going. So, the first thing is to start with just overall general information. This tab is going to allow you to put in all of your company information and your company name, the website name, pick whether you're a company or a person. So as a blogger, you could use this as well. It also allows you to plug right into Google Webmaster Tools and Bing. It also allows you to use Alexa verification tools as well. And it also has a security feature where you can disable the advanced box part of SEO. I'm actually going to be going over that advanced box at the very end of this presentation. So that way, if you're not the only author or you don't trust your authors, you can actually disable your authors from making SEO changes on your behalf. So this box right here is going to be the main general information tab. So you're going to fill in your website name, whether you're a company or a person, and then putting in your information there. If you have a company logo, you can upload that as well. All of this information is going into the Google Knowledge Database. So it's not necessarily pertinent or that you have to have it, but it's definitely great so that Google has more information about your business. The next box is going to be your Webmaster Tools that I was just talking about. So that's where you're going to actually go into Google Webmaster Tools, into Bing Webmaster Tools, and Alexa verification, set yourself up in those, and copy and paste your verification codes right into these boxes. If you have any questions about that process, I'll be in the happiness bar at 2 o'clock, and I'll be more than happy to run through some of that with you guys. And then the security box is just a checkbox to disable the ability for your authors to fill in your SEO information. So titles and metas. This is what people see when they're on the search engine. So when you have your title, that title bar that people are clicking on, separator is, your standard separator. So if you wanted to use a dash or a pipe, you could do that. It's got a plethora of options for your standard separator, but the two that are the least spammy are gonna be these two right here. You're also given the ability to force rewrite your titles. So if your theme isn't necessarily built to SEO standards and doesn't allow Yoast to just automatically rewrite your titles, you can check a checkbox that's going to basically say, no, I want control, we're going to force rewrite these for you. And you're able to create a template for all of your title and metadata for each different type of page, post, and taxonomy, including your archives. So that way, when you're setting everything up, if you want one thing to look one way and something else to look another, you can do all of that right within the main setup of this plugin. You're also able to eliminate your duplicate content concerns. A lot of times, what you'll find is that if you have an article that is posted and you're using tags and categories, sometimes you'll end up where Google will see it as duplicated content throughout the site. So you're able to use this feature to eliminate that from happening. Okay, so this is all of your title separator choices. And like I said, the dash and the pipe are the two that people are more likely to click on. So that's one of the things that I recommend. And then that's the checkbox for enabling the force rewrite of titles if your theme isn't allowing Yoast to do that already. And then this is where you're able to put in your formulas for that. And there's actually a help sheet on all of the different pieces and parts that you can plug in. So we can go over that in the happiness bar if you guys have additional questions as well. But there is a link right inside the plugin to all of that formula information. And then this is the archive. So it's the same thing as the other two. So you're just able to put in a template. And then for duplicate content prevention, you're able to actually say, no, Google, I want to not index this. So that way, Google doesn't say, okay, well, you've got duplicated content here, duplicated content there. So that's going to help you with your overall results. Duplicated content is one of those things where you really can get dinged pretty bad by Google and how far you drop in the search rankings when you get hit with a duplicated content issue. So that's something that you really want to pay attention to on your site. So the social aspect of everything. One of the things with social is that you want to make sure that you have whatever is pertinent to your business set up. And then what you're going to do is just provide the URLs inside of this tool. So for Facebook, you're able to actually provide your information so that way you can have easy Facebook insight for people who are coming from your Facebook to your website, and you're able to see all of that conversion traffic. And then for Twitter, you're able to easily set up Twitter cards, so that way when you're making posts and things, you're able to see, you know, on Twitter, the rich pictures and all of your tweets. And so that's gonna help drive tweet traffic and Twitter traffic, because people are more likely to click on your tweets and respond and read them if there's a picture involved. And then for Pinterest, you're able to verify your site on Pinterest, so that way you have that cross-communication. And of course, Google Plus. So this is gonna add specific post metadata into your Google Plus page, so that way you're communicating with your poster. It's very easy to set up. Like I said, you're just gonna post your URLs in here. So they actually have more than just the ones that they integrate with, but these are the ones that you can put your URLs into. And then for Facebook, you're able to put in a standard image URL for posts. You're able to go ahead and link your Facebook account right there inside the plugin. And And then for Twitter, you're able to set up Twitter cards so that way when you're making a post to your site, you can have that Twitter card created with that rich image inside of Twitter. And then for Pinterest, you're able to verify your Pinterest on here. This is the one thing I haven't done yet. I've done it on other sites. I haven't done it on my site, so I don't have the verification link in here. And then for Google Plus, setting it up so that way you've got all of your specific metadata communicating back. Okay, sitemaps. There are tons of sitemap plugins, but with Yoast, you don't need them, which is great. So this is going to be able to add your sitemap to your site, and it's going to automatically make updates when you do. So you don't have to worry about pulling sitemaps constantly or telling your plugin, hey, update my sitemap, I just made changes. So it's going to eliminate some of those steps because not all plugins are automatic. And setup for sitemaps is so simple. All you're going to do is check the checkbox. That's it at the top. So once you check that checkbox, it's going to enable all of your sitemap functionality. You can go in and set up specific user sitemaps. You can set up specific post types or taxonomies to not be included on your sitemap. I haven't found a reason yet that you would need to do that, but I'm sure the possibility exists, or they wouldn't have created it that way. But yeah, so you're able to actually go in and set everything up that way if you need to specifically say, no, I don't want this on my site. Okay, so there's a lot of tools built in to this plugin as well. There's a bulk editor, and what that bulk editor allows you to do is it actually allows you to go in and see all of your pages, title tags, and you can just go through and edit line by line each one. So you're not having to go into the page, update the information on the page. So if you have over, one of the sites I'm working on right now has over 380 like actual pages and posts on their site. So I'm able to use this bulk editor so that I'm not having to go through each page, finding them in the dashboard and making the edits in there. So it's very handy for larger sites. It's got a file editor, and this is primarily used for more hardcore SEO type of things, because you're actually able to go in and edit the actual backend files. And then you've got the import and export. So this is gonna be actual settings. So if you were coming from a different website and you wanted all of the same settings that we just went through to be identical on this new site, you could export it from the old site and import it to the new site. So if you're setting up a lot of sites that are the same, that would be a good use of that import-export function. Because it's not going to bring over your title tags, it's not going to bring over your meta description, it's just bringing over what checkboxes do I have checked off. And then Yoast offers a lot of extensions. They're all paid, but they have a local SEO extension. So if you're a local brick and mortar business, or you're a local business that travels to your customer. So let's say you're the ice cream shop down the street, or you're the plumber that goes to people's houses. This is going to give you a lot of options as far as being able to connect to your local-based search engine functions, your Google Plus page, and your like Yahoo local pages and all of that. So if you have any questions about local SEO, I do a lot of that as well, so catch me at the happiness bar. They have a premium plugin that adds a few additional features. I haven't paid for it yet. video stuff on your site, it'll help you really work out the meta that has to do with videos specifically. They also have a news plugin. So you know how on Google when you search and you've got the got your regular search, your images, and then that news tab? That plugin is going to help you show up in there. So for press releases and stuff like that, that's where that news SEO plugin is going to come in. And then the Google Analytics plugin. This is going to help you not have to put all of that code snippet from Google Analytics onto your site. So if you want to purchase the plugin because you're not a developer, you're not a coder, you don't know where to put that code, this is definitely going to help you with that. And if you're a WooCommerce or you do any type of e-commerce type of thing, they have a WooCommerce SEO plugin. When you get into WooCommerce, there's a lot of stuff on the search engine side that you need to keep in mind. So when you're in that space, you want to make sure that you're doing everything possible for your items to be found. Because you're in business to sell them. And if you're not selling them, you're not making money. So you want to make sure that everything can be found pretty readily and pretty easily. Okay, on-page edits. This is the fun part. This is where we get into the actual nitty-gritty of changing things and making updates. So what you see here is my contact page, or the dashboard version of the SEO plugin on my contact page in the WordPress dashboard. So what it's going to do is it's going to show the actual SERP data, the search engine data. So you see where it says contact dash Sandy Edwards. And then it's got the web address, and then it has a little snippet of information. So the top in blue, that is my title tag. And then the paragraph is my meta description. So the idea here is, and for a contact page, it's kind of different. But the idea here is that whatever your keyword is, that it is displayed in your title, once or twice in your description, and you're able to actually put a focus keyword into this tool. So for me, I put contact. So it's in my title, it's in my description, and I'm able to change my title and description right there. It's not in my content, because my contact page is simply a form on my personal site, because it's a resume site. A lot of times what you'll do for your pages is you'll make sure that you've got significant text. You also want to make sure that you have at least 300 characters, preferably words, 300 words, but at least 300 characters on the page for you to be really read by Google and have enough content to be found. The other thing that you want to make sure that you do is you want to keep your title tag to 40 to 60 characters. Anything more than that is, anything less than that or anything more than that is not going to give you good results. That's like the sweet spot is 40 to 60. And then your meta description, you don't want more than 156 characters. Now, the joy of Yoast is that you can see at the bottom where it says your meta description will be limited to 156 characters, and you have 8 characters left. So they're helping you keep in line with what you're supposed to be doing when it comes to how people see you. The other thing that Yoast does well is if I were to click on that page analysis tab, it actually tells me what I'm doing wrong to an extent. There are times when you won't follow this, but for the most part, it does a pretty good job of keeping you in check. So like the first red dot that I have, it says there are 0 words contained in the body copy. Yes, Yoast, I'm aware. Thank you. Like I said, 300 words ish. So it also says that the keyword doesn't appear in the first paragraph. I don't have a first paragraph. But yes, the idea is these types of tools and tips are what you want to use. The other thing is when you log in to your website on the back end, you can actually see on each page those dots. So it'll either be red, orange, or green, or blue if you don't have Google following your page at all. But if you have a company doing your search engine optimization, you can actually see what color that is. Not all of the time will it be green. There are times when it will be orange. But if it's red, you need to contact your company and say, hey, what's going on? Because there are times when it will be orange. You can also look at the reasons why on a specific page it falls into the orange category. So that way you can really do some analysis of what this company is doing for you or not doing for you. Or should I just be doing this either myself or with someone else? The other thing that this does is it also looks at, do you have an H1 and an H2 tag, so like a main header and a secondary header, on the page. Not all pages are designed to have, you don't always want a secondary header. So if you just have a main title and you've got text and that's it, you won't have a secondary header. So you'll get a yellow light for that. But, you know, like I said, sometimes you'll end up with orange for the overall color. But it does let you know that, you know, the meta description has your main keywords. So all of this type of stuff is stuff that you are able to then adjust yourself. So, I'm going to actually show you the back end of my site. So on my pages, you can see where I've got the different dots on my individual page. So on my front page, and if it's gray, it means you haven't done anything at all with it. So with this, you're able to see exactly what I have and haven't done. And like I said, this specific site is just for my resume, so I haven't done a whole lot to it, but you're able to actually get that page analysis. Exactly what is going on. And then you're also able, in the advanced section, if you're familiar with what you're doing, you're actually able to say, no Google, I don't want your robots to follow me, to index me or to follow me. So you're actually able to update that in the advanced section. So if you know you're duplicating content on the page because you pulled the article again or whatever for a specific purpose, you can actually have Google not follow you at all. So that way it's not doing anything.
Thank you.
website on that level, you know? That way you can see what pages are on the website. This is how Google knows what to crawl. And all you have to do, like I said before, is just check that, that checkbox. What? Yes, and you're gonna, once you get this URL, you'll log back into Webmaster Tools and submit that as your sitemap. Do you guys have any questions? Okay.
How do you find duplicated content? Like, let's say I designed these little exhibits and I may have several different posts that will talk about different aspects of the exhibit. Sometimes I'll run a picture more than once, or, you know, what's the definition of duplicated content?
She's asking what the definition of duplicated content is. Anything that is identical as already written content on the internet, the number's like 90% or something.
Oh, 90%.
That's identical. It's in that ballpark.
Okay,
I could get
so
you an exact
that's
number.
Not just three sentences referring to another post. That's like
yeah, no.
Kind of reposting the thing and changing a few words.
Right, and you can't quote. So you're gonna want to put in block quotes if you're having to quote content from somewhere else. Just make sure that it's not the majority of your article. So keeping it fresh. And rewriting is okay as long as the verbiage is different. So, yeah. I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Why would you not want all of your pages to be be found on Google? there's a couple of different reasons. One of them I mentioned was, you know, the duplicate content. But sometimes you'll have something on the site that isn't pertinent to your business, but you want to send people there. So let's say you just have a forms page that is just a form, there's no title, there's no nothing. It really doesn't need to be indexed by Google because Google can't index it that well anyway. So you may have it where it's a link that you give out at a trade show or something along those lines. So it's not that you necessarily don't want to have it indexed, but it's not necessarily needed. So. What? Oh, and pay-per-click landing pages. You don't want those ever indexed. Any of your pay-per-click programs, because if you have those indexed, then you could end up with mixed traffic. So you really want your pay-per-click pages to be unique to pay-per-click instead of being able to have them searchable through Google, because you're paying for that traffic. So you want to make sure that you can track all of that and all those conversions.
First as an HTTP website, is it easy to
it's all server side. So it's not on the actual site. When he's in the happiness bar, talk to him.
I'm sorry,
when he's in the happiness bar, talk to him. Yes.
Do you have any recommendations for pages that are mostly images or galleries?
Find a way to add content.
Yeah, okay.
The other thing with that is you can add alt tags to your images. So when you're... when you're adding images into... you're adding images onto your site through media, you can come over here where it says alt text, and you can add in tags. Now, that serves two purposes. One, that's the only text on your image that Google can read. Okay. The other thing is if you have someone visually impaired, a screen reader will read that text. So you just want to make sure that whatever you're putting in there has your keyword, but is also screen reader friendly. So you want to serve two purposes. Not necessarily. The question was, does it make sense to make the page title the alt
text?
Not
the image title.
The image title.
The image title, the alt text.
As well.
The alt text is specifically for the search engines. The image title is simply for your website to pull the image down. Like the file.
The title, the title tag is for your main text, the title, and then the alt text. So the title tag is there for the back.
Sorry, could you repeat that? What were you saying? I just didn't catch any of them. Sorry, could you repeat that? Into the mic, I mean.
What were you saying? What?
Anchor tags.
Oh, anchor tags? Yeah. Right. I can't hear you.
Anchor tags for titles.
Anchor tags are for titles. And image tags are for alt tags, yes.
Okay,
thanks. Yes. You guys have questions?
Yeah, I have. I have a site I launched about a month ago. And 2 or 3 weeks ago, I just had 10 more landing pages. We got 4 landing pages. I had launched with Paul a site a couple days ago. Those pages actually have come up with. So these pages get indexed up publicly.
About every 30 days. About. I've seen things get indexed as quickly as, 5, 6, 10 days, and I've seen it last take as long as 45 days. So, but on average, give yourself 30 days.
We have two websites, small school, the main page for everybody.
Probably. The best way to check that is through like a Moz SEO tool to see how it's being rendered, as far as you're getting dinged. But come see me in the happiness bar, so that way we can look at it more in depth and see how you're doing it. Questions? Yes.
Is there any limitation on the number of characters in the alt text?
There's a recommended number. It's the same as titles, I think. Or even 60. What? Screen.
You want characters.
Right. So I recommend 40 to 60 because you have to keep in mind the screen. Like I said, so when you're talking about screen readers, the last thing that you want is to have a paragraph about one image when that screen reader is scrolling through your site. So I recommend 40 to 60 because it keeps it sweet, short to the point, it gets the point across, and it's the right size to get it indexed. So. Yes?
I always look to make sure I can read that when I'm looking for the SEO, but I've noticed some of my search results are showing images, others aren't. I wonder if that is the same or.
Probably. She's asking about images showing up in search results for some of her stuff and not for others. It could be the alt tags on the images. There's a lot of factors that go into how Google displays everything. But if you have all of your alt tags in place and everything fully, as I put it, you know, checking all the checkboxes off the form, you should be okay. But
back and check the all I that's something I just recently learned all the time, so I think I've done really
Yeah. And you will find that there are times when you'll do a search and you know what your meta description says and Google shows something else. So this isn't an end all be all. This is simply a guide for people. It's a suggestion. It's just part of their algorithm. Any other questions, comments, concerns? Yes?
You talked about all the red, yellow, green dots.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think is most important? You said maybe your page is not good for an page 2 or 3, but I always think it's good for SEO, so I do it anyway. How do you decide on what to do?
The question was, how do you decide what to do when you're looking at all of the different dots to make sure that you're, you know, as thorough as possible? I want it to make sense to my end user. So looking at everything, if it doesn't make sense to my end user, it doesn't matter because they're not going to convert on my website. So thinking in the shoes, put yourself in the shoes of whoever your end user is who's going to be looking at your website and think, okay, well, if I have an H2 on this website, does it make it less easy to navigate? If it does, don't use it. You know, making sure that you do have content. If you need to move the content to the bottom of the page because it's not pertinent to your user, it's just pertinent to the search engine, I can't tell you the number of times I've done that, where I have the form and then the content. So. You know, sometimes you just have to get creative, think outside of the box. That way you get as much done as you can for the search engines, but at the same time you're making it as easy as possible for your user to get to your site, get where they need to go, and give you money.
And one other question. Google's now changing all the mobile results. Is there a Yoast, like the new updates, do they indicate it?
She's asking about considering for everything for mobile. Responsive, responsive, responsive. If your website's not responsive, get with somebody now to make it responsive. And you can work with the designer if you're not currently responsive on how your content will display and what will show up and how it will render on a mobile device. Google will see, if you're using responsive design, Google's going to see everything on that desktop version as far as all of the code. So that way, when it goes down to responsive, if you have something that's not displaying, as far as search engines are concerned, it's still there.
Yeah, but
so,
I understand that, but does Yoast do anything with it? Are there any recommendations or whatever? Is there?
Oh yeah, well Yoast does update with their algorithm changes. So whenever a new algorithm change comes out, they do update everything. But as soon as they, as far as like the mobile thing specifically, it's not a big deal. But they do, Yoast does keep everything up to date. So that way you are kind of, in a sense, word free.
Sandy, can we see your latest project?
I'm sorry, what?
Can we see your latest project? That's okay.
I'm trying to think if it's under an NDA. I think it's under an NDA. Yeah, I don't think I'm allowed to, unfortunately, because I'm under an NDA on that one, because it's not launched yet.
How and when do you use the in-and-out-of-order URL in the field of reviews?
How often should you use...
How and when?
How and when real one redirects?
Yeah, in-and-out-of-order URL in the field.
Anytime you're... Right, okay, so anytime that you are changing sites or site structure, you're going to want to use a 301 redirect. So most of the time that happens when you build a new site, to be honest. If you're changing site structure for any other reason, you still want to use them. They're not for it. A lot of people think that it's like the worst thing you can do. They're not. It's better than having a 404 page. So when you look in the grand scheme of things, you're better off. I've got time for one more question. Awesome. Well, thank you guys for coming. And at 2 o'clock, I'll be in the happiness bar if you guys run into any other questions or if you want me to look over something specifically.